this lecture, we're going to develop the concept of acid-base strength a little more and look at the consequence of acid-base strength on an aqueous solution. Just to recall, the term strength refers to the ability to accept or donate a proton. So a strong acid is a species that donates a proton readily, whereas a weak acid is a species that is not a very effective proton donor. A strong base is a species that accepts a proton readily, and a weak base is one that does not. In this lecture, we're going to explain the difference between strong and weak in terms of what happens in an aqueous acid solution, but the same argument applies to a base solution as well. And let's begin our explanation by looking at aqueous acids. What we have to understand is that when we dissolve an acid in water, it is the reaction or the interaction of the acid with the water in which it's dissolved that determines the predominant available proton donor or acceptor. What we have to realize is that when we dissolve an acid in water, the aqueous solution it forms contains two different species, the undissociated form of the acid and its dissociated form. Here we have a reaction which represents what happens when we dissolve any generalized acid in water. We represent any acid with the symbol HA. In this case, HA, when dissolved in water, reacts with the first available water molecule, HOH, to produce hydronium ions and the balancing species A negative. We say that the undissociated form of the acid is HA. And if HA reacts or donates its proton to water, we would form H3O plus and A minus. Now, the form that the acid takes, whether it remains HA or whether it becomes H3O plus and A minus, depends on its strength. If we take a strong acid and dissolve it in water, the first thing it'll do is donate its H plus to the first available proton acceptor, which in this case would turn out to be a water molecule. The result is that the effect of dissolving a strong acid in water, or to make a solution of a strong acid, is for the strong acid to quantitatively or 100% dissociate into H3O+. So an acid like hydrochloric acid dissolves in water and transfers its proton immediately upon dissolving to form entirely hydronium and chloride ions. If we were to look at that on the molecular level, we would see that every hydrogen chloride molecule that was dissolved in water will immediately transfer its proton, so that the solution contains only hydronium ions and chloride ions. Another way of looking at that is if we start off with hydrogen chloride, by the time it has completely dissolved, all we will have are hydronium ions and chloride ions left. We call this tendency to dissociate completely the leveling effect. The leveling effect is the term we use to refer to the property of a strong acid to dissociate in water. Because of its strong proton donating ability, we would find no molecular acid left in a solution of a strong acid. The leveling effect, then, is the tendency for all strong acids to dissociate completely when they're dissolved in water. That means that the strongest acid species you can ever have in water is H3O+. Any acid stronger than H3O+ would dissociate completely upon dissolving. That means that regardless of whether you have hydrochloric acid or hydroiodic acid, or you have nitric acid, they are all effectively solutions of hydronium ions and their balancing species. Then how is a weak acid solution different than a strong acid solution? Well, when you dissolve a weak acid in water, it will attempt to do the same thing. It will attempt to donate its proton to the first available acceptor, which again turns out to be a water molecule. But this process is inefficient and is limited by the poor proton-donating ability of the weak acid. The transfer of hydronium ions is then not quantitative, and what you get at equilibrium is a mixture of molecular acid and dissociated species. Our example will involve hydrofluoric acid, which is a weak acid. Hydrofluoric acid dissociates about 25% upon dissolving in water to form hydronium ions, and in this case, fluoride ions. That means if we were able to look at the molecular level, we would see that about 3/4 of the hydrofluoric acid molecules that dissolve do not transfer a proton, and only about 25% or 1/4 effectively donate a proton to form hydronium and fluoride ions. A solution of hydrofluoric acid then is mostly undissociated HF, and only a small portion has dissociated into hydronium ions and the balancing species F negative. That means that a solution of hydrofluoric acid only contains a small amount of hydronium and is mostly HF. Now we can understand in a little more detail what this acid-base dissociation table is indicating to us. First, we now can understand why the hydronium ion is highlighted. What that highlighting means is that regardless of what strong acid we started with, once we dissolve it in water, they are all effectively converted into solutions of hydronium ion and their balancing species. Remember, that's what we call the leveling effect. Therefore, any strong acid exists as a solution of H3O+. And on our table, a strong acid is any acid which is above the hydronium ion. That means that a weak acid is any acid which is below the hydronium ion. Our table begins with oxalic acid, and the weak acids get progressively less dissociated as we work our way down until eventually we hit water molecules. To summarize, when you dissolve an acid or base in water, they can be found in one of two forms, their undissociated form or their dissociated form. The primary species that you find in solution, that is, whether you find the dissociated or undissociated species, is determined by the strength of the acid or base involved. Strong acids and bases are converted completely into their dissociated form. A strong acid gets completely converted into H3O+, and a strong base is completely converted into OH- upon dissolving in water. Weak acids and bases only partially dissociate when they are added to water. They will only form a small amount of H3O+ or a small amount of OH-, and they exist almost entirely in their undissociated form. In the next lecture, we're going to show you how we can quantitatively describe the difference between a strong acid and base.